Hi, it's Rob from Speaker's Corner, and welcome to this critique and review of a conversation or part of a conversation that I had with Shabir Yusuf some months ago in Speaker's Corner. A number of Muslims consider Shabir to be one of the top debaters, speakers, knowledgeable people that comes to Speaker's Corner, and obviously I'm very keen to have conversations with the most knowledgeable people that I can find to see what their views are, why they believe what they do, and whether there's some faults in my views. That's the only way I'm going to learn. That's the way I'm going to improve my knowledge. And with that said, this was a conversation that starts at this particular point talking about a gay marriage. And so we're going to go through this 25, 27 minute odd video, and I'm going to stop it at various points and point out some things that I think Shabir made a mistake on, some of the things that I made a mistake on that I didn't do that I could have done differently. I've been through this video already, so there'll be many points here where I'll be stopping and saying various things. To begin with, there's two things I want to point out for you to notice. There's two things that I noticed that Shabir does when he's having conversations that I don't feel are as valuable as they could be. The most important one is, instead of oftentimes making a claim, Shabir starts to ask a number of questions to try and get back to a claim that he would otherwise very easily make. So, for example, he could quite easily in this conversation say, I'm against gay marriage because there's this wrong with it, that wrong with it, this wrong with it. It says it's wrong in the Quran. Plus, there's this other evidence that I feel makes gay marriage wrong. That would be a very easy way to start a conversation, to put his claim forward and why he believes it. Now we can examine that. But as you'll notice here, as we go through this rather long part of the conversation, he doesn't do that. He starts to ask a lot of questions, and I don't feel this is a productive way of actually getting to truth, because the questions that he asks isn't questions to come to truth. These are questions to try and get back to some kind of proposition or assertion that could be made right in the beginning. So that's point number one. The other thing that doesn't happen quite so much in this particular video is that Shabir will say, I agree with you, however, or I agree with you, but. And this is kind of a negation term in common language. What we would normally say is, I disagree with that, and here's why. But Shabir does it the other way around. And what I will certainly do in future when we have conversations is, the moment he says, I agree with you, I'm going to say, Shabir, great. What is it that you actually agree with me? Can you tell me what you agree with me about? Because otherwise it's just a term that isn't very helpful, and he could rather say, I disagree with you and here's why. But saying, I agree with you, but, isn't the great way to have this sort of conversation, because it's actually the wrong way to say something unless there's something that you actually agree with and you can point out what our agreement is. So with those two points said, we're now going to get into the video. And as I said, I'm going to stop it at various points and make some comments. And hopefully this is useful. Maybe you disagree with me. Please feel free to comment where you feel I've made a mistake that I haven't picked up, or if you agree with something Shabir says that I don't, and why you agree with it. I'm totally fine with being incorrect about my views on things. All I want is for people to say you're wrong, and here's why you're wrong, so I can examine it. So with that said, let's get started.
Somebody asked me, and I honestly, this happened, okay? Somebody asked me, what is wrong with a gay relationship? Yeah?
That's a bit of a gay relationship.
Okay. What is wrong with it? I said, right, okay, let us use this as an example. You raised it, yeah? Number one, the word marriage, okay, has already got a worldwide definition.
Sure.
Yeah? That between a male and a female. We can easily assert that, look, this was as a result of religious teachings going all over the world. Whatever the reason may be, the fact is we have a consensus.
Okay, so at this point, Shabir states that we have a consensus worldwide that a marriage is between a man and a woman. If we look at, here is the same-sex marriage of Wikipedia, the number of countries in which same-sex marriage or gay marriage is legal, you can see they're highlighted in blue. My count is at least 21 countries where same-sex marriage is legally allowed, either nationwide or in some parts. So yes, the majority of the world still says that, or doesn't allow gay sex marriage. However, there's at least 21 countries that do. And what I could have said here is, which country or countries are we referring to? Because using the world as an example isn't the ideal way to have this conversation, because clearly there are countries where same-sex or gay marriage is legal. So are we talking about the UK here, or are we talking about the entire world, which I don't think is useful in the sense of getting clear on what area we are talking about, because clearly there are differences.
That consensus says that marriage is defined between a male and a female. So when you said gay marriage, obviously we had a problem already,
sure,
in terms of definition. But if we say a gay relationship, yeah? Now, as a human being, I want to know what is wrong with it. Or what is right with it?
Is there something wrong with it?
Exactly.
So I ask you.
What is right with it? Well, like I said, when I was asked this question, okay, I would look at explanations naturalistically. Okay? And I would ask myself this. Okay, let us assume this was a case. Yeah. The first thing I would want to know, because when you ask, what is there anything wrong with it, yes, that would be on a psychological level and guaranteed on a subjective basis.
Okay, so at this moment, Shabir talks about it being on a psychological level. Yes, that is one level at which we can look at whether gay marriage is wrong. We can also look at it on a physical level. We could look at it on a biological level. We could look at it on a sociological level. So there's many levels that we could look at this particular issue and ask the question, is it right or wrong? In other words, is there negative effects or is there positive effects? And does the positive outweigh the negative, or the negative outweigh the positive? So there's a number of ways we can do it. Shabir chose to focus here just on the psychological.
Certainly not objective, yeah? Because we would need the evidence to assess, to be able to objectively formulate a conclusion.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
So whatever we are going to be discussing about gay marriage is going to be what? Purely subjective?
Not necessarily, no.
Okay, so what is the objective evidence?
Well, you could test it. You could test the psychological well-being.
No, when you say you can test, it means has any test been undertaken?
Okay, so this is a little bit of a red herring at this moment in time, because Shabir is now asking me to produce some kind of objective evidence on the spot. Now, no doubt if we go and look into literature and testing and psychology, I'm fairly certain we could find something. I haven't looked at the moment. However, I'm quite willing for somebody to say, actually, here's evidence or psychological testing that shows, in fact, that gay marriage is wrong. If there is something like that, I am totally fine. And that, and with, if that were the case, then we could confidently assert that there is a negative effect to gay marriage. We'd still have to weigh up how negative that is versus the potential positive outcomes of gay marriage, that are people are happy, they're living a great life, they are interacting with other people in a much better way, in the sense that they are happy and fulfilled in their relationship. So we still have to weigh it up. However, here he's asking for something on the spot here, which I don't have. So I start to talk about what I think sort of testing could be.
I'm guessing there must have been, surely.
All right, well, that's speculation then. But I agree with you. There must have been. Yeah.
Okay, so he says that that's speculation, but I agree with you. So what exactly is he agreeing with me? That there's been testing? You know, this whole I agree with you, but is what I want to point out here. This, again, do you agree with me? And if so, on what great basis do you agree with me? Or if you don't agree with me, just say I don't agree with you. Then at least we know where we stand.
Yes. Okay. However, yeah, you see, for us to definitively answer a question, it is only reasonable to have the evidence available again.
No, no.
But let me carry on. Now, I've asked two questions and on both you have said, I guess. So we are speculating. But I'll take this further. You see, I would view it on a naturalistic level. And I would ask myself this. In absence of a creator, yeah, what explanation do we have for us being here? On a very simplistic level, I'm taking this, okay? How have we come here?
Shabir asks, this is where the questions start. Instead of at this point, Shabir could have said, you know what, I think gay marriage is wrong, and I think it's wrong on an evolutionary biological point of view, and here's why, X, Y, and Z. So here the questions start, in order not to necessarily get to truth, in my opinion, but in a roundabout way to get back to a claim that he could make at this very point. And so we're now off on to how do we get here in the sense of, as you'll see, about evolution. But this could have been stated from his point of view directly and would have shortened the whole process, and then we can actually get into the meat, because these questions that are being asked now are not the main questions. These are side questions, sidetrack in a sense questions, to get back to a main point. And they go on and they expand the length of this conversation where it could have been much shorter. And in my opinion, they don't add a lot to the conversation, if anything.
How have me and you come here? On a naturalistic level, okay? How have we come? The marriage issue now, we can put aside. Yeah, let's call it a relationship. Yeah, a relationship.
Okay, so he says we can put the marriage issue or the relationship aside. No, that's the main conversation. That's the main thrust of our entire conversation, is it right or wrong for gay marriage or gay relationship, whichever term you want to use. That is the crux of this entire conversation. I'm claiming that without evidence to the contrary, I don't see why it's wrong. Obviously, he has a different point of view, but he's not clear on pointing that out and why he says it's wrong. And I think as you notice as we go through this video, he's never clear on exactly why he feels that it's wrong.
On a naturalistic level, how have me and you met?
Okay, so how is that relevant to the gay thing? I'm just trying to make the connection, because you seem to have gone off on something else.
Not at all. You see, it's a relationship, isn't it?
Okay, so I've asked him, you seem to have gone off on something else. In other words, you started to go towards, you know, evolution or biology. How is this relevant? And so let's listen to see if we can understand how this is relevant to evaluating the claim that gay marriage is right or wrong. Remember, that's our main claim. We are evaluating whether gay marriage is right or wrong. Keep that in mind this entire conversation.
What is
the gay relationship we are discussing? What is the, now again, you see, what is the definition of a relationship?
An interaction between two people.
Is that all it is?
You could be more. I'm not sure where you're going with it. So
don't worry about where. We are.
Okay, so again, these questions are not necessarily relevant, or if they are, it's a roundabout way of doing it. He could say, a relationship is this, and he can give a definition, and then I can agree or disagree. So he now asks me to provide the definition here, and I've got to try and think in my head, which is not something I have off the top of my head, the exact definition of a relationship, or a gay relationship for that matter. So I still am challenged to find out how these particular questions are useful when Shabir could actually state his position directly and then give his reasons, then we could evaluate it.
Exploring a particular issue.
Yeah. All I'm asking, all over the show, and all I'm asking, is it wrong? So you presumably will say yes and you will have a reason.
No, I already told you, I don't look at it that way.
Okay, so he tells me he doesn't look at it that way. He doesn't have a position and he doesn't want to say what his position is. So he wants to go this sort of questioning route, which is like a back way around type of thing in order to get to a position. Let's see if by the end of this we've actually got to his position so we can clearly understand what his position is.
You see, I said to you, there are various facets to this relationship. That is why when you raise gay marriage, I first said, what's the definition of marriage? You see, because from what I'm respectfully seeing is you have got preconceived notions and you are trying to fit it in. What I'm saying is, let's not do that.
Okay, so he says, I have preconceived notions and I'm trying to fit it in. This is a claim he makes, which he never actually backs up. What I should have said is, what do you mean by preconceived notions and how am I trying to fit it in? That would have been a very good question from my point of view to ask him here, because he's made a claim about my position, but he hasn't given any reasons or evidence as to why he feels that's the case.
Let's go with the evidence as it is available. So when I said to you, okay, on a naturalistic level, what is the relationship?
It's an interaction between two people. Let's maybe say more words to it.
What do you mean by maybe more words to it?
You could define it.
Okay, let's call it an intimate relationship. Can
sure.
we call it that?
Yep, you can call it that.
Okay, on a naturalistic level, what kind of intimate relationship are we discussing here?
I'm not sure I follow your question.
Okay.
So give me the answer then, if you like.
Well, that would be too easy, wouldn't it?
Notice here, Shabir says that would be too easy. It's almost like this is a bit of a game. I'm going to question you, and if you can't answer every one of my questions, either that will confuse you, or I might, you know, walk away feeling like I've kind of got the upper hand. And in my position, looking at the questions that are being asked, these questions are unnecessary because Shabir could make the assertion, he could give his reasons, we could then examine it. That's the key part of this whole thing. Remember what we're doing here? We're trying to evaluate whether gay marriage is right or wrong. So these secondary side questions are really to try and get back to something that he could then assert confidently because I've answered all the questions to make his position correct. I think it's better that you state your position and then you give your reasons why.
I would say that what we need to do is assess the evidence. Now, obviously, the question that you have raised, okay, you are expecting for me to say, no, I'm sorry, it is wrong.
Yes, I'm expecting you to say, no, it's wrong, and your reasons why, or yes, it's correct, and here's my reasons why. That's how most rational people have a conversation. That's what I've done. I've said, yes, I think it's right, and until somebody can demonstrate that there's some proven negativity, for want of a better word, then, you know, am I justified in thinking that it's right in the sense that right means that the people who are involved have a positive effect and there aren't any negative effects? Or if there are negative effects, how big are they?
I would say, look, to be able to justifiably say something is wrong, I will have needed the evidence to be able to formulate a conclusion. And if you listen to me, that's what I have consistently said, that sometimes if I look at the evidence and I look at it and think, wait a minute, let me research some more and find out what is going on here. So
at this point, I should have asked the question, okay, so you've researched the evidence to find out what is going on here, to use his words. What is your conclusions based on the evidence that you have researched? But of course, I don't do that because he's in the mode of asking questions at the moment. So it's a good learning for me. As I listen to claims that are being made, I'm immediately going to jump in future and say, okay, you've made a claim. Please explain why you've said that or what reasons you have for that opinion or assertion you've made.
You tell me now, and I'm going to tell you that based on the evidence that I I'll confidently assert that the relationship between a male and a male and a female, yes, to a certain extent, there's nothing wrong with it. But there is an extent beyond that, which then falls into what I would call the realm of negativity.
Okay, so if you listen to that part of what Shabir said, he will confidently assert that to some degree, the male-male and male-female relationship is positive and then it falls into the realm of negativity. He doesn't, of course, mention female-female. So in his mind, a gay relationship is potentially only between two men, or that's all he's thinking about, at least in this conversation. I'm sure if I asked him, he would say that that also extends to two women. But in his mind, probably two men are a lot worse potentially, and I'm making that assumption, than two women. He certainly leaves that out here.
In terms of well-being, no, I just said it's based on what I have read.
Yeah, and a third one as well.
Good. Now, the first thing I think
of, battery good?
Human beings, okay? Leaving God aside, we come to what other explanations of life.
That's what I say, you should call him.
We would say it would be evolution.
That's not the origin of life.
Definitely not.
Correct.
Abiogenesis is separate. Okay.
Explosion.
But let us assume that it has happened because we are here.
Correct.
Something has happened.
Correct.
Okay. So we are here. Now, if I were to take the theory of evolution into this particular discussion, okay, I would find, and you tell me if I'm wrong anywhere here.
Sure.
Yes. I would find that natural selection determined, I'm using the words like as though we are talking about intelligent entities,
yes,
but there's something which we have to deal with.
Sure.
Yes? Something determined, natural selection in this instance, determined the method by which living things, yeah, not only human beings, living things have arrived at where they are.
Correct.
How?
Okay, so again, we start going into questions here that I don't feel get to the point. Shabir could clearly have said here, I believe evolution and the mechanism of natural selection is between a man and a woman, and that's a natural phenomenon. Anything else is unnatural, and that could be considered bad. Great, now you've made a claim. Now we can examine that and talk about that particular claim and your reason for why you say that. But we don't do that. We start going into the questions. So he's asking me to try and answer these questions to come back to what he could assert himself. I apologize that I keep repeating it, but you can see this is a pattern going through this entire conversation here of asking questions where you can easily make an assertion and then you can give your reasons why.
But that mechanism worked, natural selection determined it.
I know where you're going, so yes, that's cool.
If you know where I'm going, then it makes my life easier.
Good. If it makes your life easier, please, Shabir, could you get to the point here? Your continual questions here just prolongs this, and in fact, I don't think helps us get to the truth any quicker or even as well as we could have had we made the assertions and examined the actual assertions rather than ask these questions.
You see, I know and you know that we have to agree on this because the evidence points to that. So the first question is on that mechanical level, why do you think natural selection decreed, I use the word, you know what I mean. Why do you think natural selection determined that the mechanical relationship between a male and a female is the appropriate vehicle for natural selection to operate as effectively as it has?
Okay, can you see that's a very sort of long question? And if you rewind it and you listen to the question again and put yourself in the position of somebody who's being asked to answer that question, you can see it's a long question that's kind of leading in a sense. What I mean by that is there is a particular answer that Shabir wants to get to, but he doesn't actually want to state it himself. He wants me to provide the answer so that he doesn't have to.
You're aware that many animals are, there's examples, I'd have to go look them up, but there are examples of animals that are, quote, that same sex. You're aware of it.
I simply point out that there are animals in the animal kingdom where same-sex homosexuality happens. So there's definitely animals out there in which that happens. Because his claim here is that evolution allows only a male and female to interact in a sexual way and to obviously produce offspring. Now, we can agree that obviously male-female produce offspring, although there are some animals that can produce offspring without mating with another animal. There's a specific term for that which escapes me in the moment now, but there certainly are. So I'm simply pointing out here that there are animals that have a homosexual relationship. I'm not claiming, obviously, that they can produce further offspring, but that isn't really, the claim. We're looking at originally, if we remember, is gay marriage, particularly between humans and not animals, right or wrong? And is this in any way helping us move towards that?
But that's not the issue, though. I didn't ask you that. I asked you, and I'm asking you again.
Yeah.
The vehicle that natural selection determined was that of a male and a female.
For a human being.
No, I didn't say human being. All living being. Because you see, if we trace it back to the unicellular organism.
I won't split hairs with you. Let's accept that.
It's not about splitting hairs. It's an important point.
When I say I don't want to split hairs, what I really mean is I'm accepting your premise that, let's say, most animals, it's a male and a female that interact in natural selection through evolution. So I'm fine with that. Let's get on with the next point.
You see, we are not splitting hairs. What we are actually determining is a particular issue based on the exclusion of a creator based on what we call natural selection. If natural selection determined that the method that it employed is this one, okay, I would suggest to you that if we use the language in its format that it is, anything that is other than that would be what?
Listen to that sort of question again. So natural selection has used this mechanism, and anything that would be other than that would be what? Think of it, if you're the person receiving that as a question, how intelligible is that question? Maybe you will immediately have the answer here because you've watched the video, but imagine you hadn't watched the video and you were asked that question.
Natural. That sounds reasonable to me.
So somebody behind Shabir says unnatural, and he turns around almost with like feigned surprise going, that sounds reasonable to me. He could have made this claim 2 or 3 minutes ago and said evolution through natural selection male and female is the natural way to do things. Now we can have the conversation.
Okay, but that is again, based on our
collective minds,
depend on the definition of natural.
Which we have to everything else.
But the mechanics, the mechanics of breeding have got an issue this, which I think we need to consider here. If I tell you, yes, are you married?
Yes.
You're married? Okay, great stuff. If I tell you, okay, has your wife cooked you a meal today?
No.
She hasn't. I said, right, can you just give me the biggest stick you can find here? There you are, we'll sort it out.
Okay, so at this point, this is, again, to me, particularly an irrelevant question. Shabir obviously has something in his mind that he's trying to get to with this example. What I should have done here is kept quiet or asked, what do you mean by sorted out? But I don't. I assume what he means is I should use the stick on my wife because she hasn't made me dinner. That's kind of what he's wanting me to do. And I kind of, in a sense, fall into this trap. But I should have just kept quiet or asked, what do you mean by sort it out?
Would you agree with me?
You mean as in to go and use the stick on her?
How did you guess that?
Because that's kind of... What else would you use the stick for? Yeah. To make a fire?
Possibly.
Because I know where you're coming from. I'm assuming where you're coming from.
Okay, so I'm assuming where you're coming from is what I said, and I'm quite hands up to say that that's not a good position from my point. I've made an assumption there because he's led me towards that to some point, but I've made an assumption. What I should have done is kept quiet or, as I say, asked, what should I do with a stick or what do you mean by sort it out? So clarify, because when he says sort it out, we can assume what he means, but actually maybe a better way is to ask a question, what do you mean? Because it's a kind of generalistic statement.
You see, that is why I raised it. Okay, but now the question is this, you know and I know, you don't do that. I certainly would not do it, but the question is this, if, and here is, I raised it with one of the brothers here, and I'm just using it as an example of this relationship between a gay relationship, yeah, and the psychological well-being, the point that you made.
Okay, so I do want you to listen closely now. He's going to bring up an example now that he feels is relevant to a gay relationship and the psychological well-being of a gay relationship. So keep that in mind. What we're trying to establish here is the psychological well-being of a gay relationship. Could we consider it moral? In other words, is it good or is it negative? And on what basis do we say that? So keep that in mind as we go forward with this example.
I was sad, you know, on one of my sales trips. And this is just an example. I'm not saying it really happened. Otherwise, my wife will crucify me. Okay?
You're recording something.
Yeah, exactly. Okay? I was sat there, and this lady comes and sits down. And we share a coffee. And I came to realize, yes, that she had serious problems. And she started telling me, yes, she's pouring everything out. Okay? And it came to a point, don't ask how, okay? But it came to a point where the only reasonable way to safeguard her well-being was me to have an intimate relationship with her.
Okay, let me stop it here because this will be the crux of the next sort of 5-minute conversation. His example here is that the only reasonable way for him to safeguard her well-being was for him to have an intimate relationship with her. And you'll see I'll ask him questions later on, well, what's the consequences of not having an intimate relationship with her? But think about this. I spoke to my wife about this a couple of times now, and she's struck her head against the wall and kind of gone, what? This seems to be the most ridiculous example you can possibly come up with. Here he's saying, the only reasonable way for me to safeguard her well-being is for me to have an intimate relationship with me. What I should have done at this exact moment is, please explain to me how that's the only, or in your view, the most reasonable position you could take. You could phone somebody up, you could call the police, you could call civil services, you could call somebody to try and help her if she's in a bad state, which is what he goes on to say. But this example itself, to me, is utterly ridiculous, and we will go with it. But every now and again, I'm going to remind you that this is the example that Shabir himself brought up.
How did you come to that?
I just said, watch, don't ask yet. But I did, yes? And because it's for her well-being, I undertook the project. Is there anything wrong with it?
Okay, so he hasn't gone into details, and you'll see that I will ask him certain questions. He's basically just said that the most reasonable position to safeguard her well-being is for me to have an intimate relationship with her. Is that right or wrong? Now, that in and of itself, if I never asked any other questions, I could then be put into a position where I could say, okay, that's right, and he would say, no, that's wrong. So what I actually do, as you'll see, is ask a few questions, because the consequences of the action is very important. So let's see.
Depends if it's the only option available.
That was the only option.
Notice he now says it's the only option. Originally, he said at just around 10 minutes 40, he said that the most reasonable way to safeguard her well-being was for me to have an intimate relationship. Now he says it's the only option.
So are you asking, is that okay based on well-being as the benchmark?
Absolutely.
So what was the consequences of not doing it?
That's the important question that I ask. What is the consequence of not having an intimate relationship with her? Because this is key.
Okay, I'll tell you. Can I go and now tell my wife? Would you do it?
Okay, so he doesn't actually answer the question of what is the consequences. He asked me a question, which is, would I tell my wife? That's not the answer to the question that I was asking.
But you said the woman was in a really bad state.
She had a bad state, but for her well-being,
yes,
I undertook the exercise.
So my question to you is, what would be the consequences had you not undertaken that exercise?
She would have committed suicide.
Okay.
Ah, there we go. So now, when I've pressed him a little bit, we've got to the point that if he didn't have an intimate relationship with her, she would have committed suicide. So this entire example is, I sat with a woman, she was incredibly depressed. I found out that the only way to safeguard her well-being, or the only way now, he's saying, to safeguard her well-being, in other words, to keep her from committing suicide, is to have an intimate relationship with her. Now think about this, if this is in any way a practical or even a good example in principle, in other words, in theory, like a thought experiment. I've spoken to my wife, I've spoken to other people, and they sort of shake their head in disbelief that we could use this as an example. Now this isn't to say that there aren't good examples where we really can question my version of morality, but this one is clearly not a good example in any sense.
You saved her from committing suicide.
Respectfully, I would say this. Whatever the consequences were, come after.
Okay, so here he says, whatever the consequences are, come after. And I would confidently assert, no, you will consider the consequences prior to engaging in any act. And actually, he admits this later on. Think about it. Anytime you are going to commit an act, and let's say you were going to commit or were thinking about committing an adulterous act, because actually that's what he's talking about. But he's framed it in such a way that he's saying, well, I'm committing this adulterous act because she was about to commit suicide. So again, that part of the example is quite ridiculous. But let's assume we're going with it because it's what he said. That's the question you have to ask yourself, is you will consider what the consequences are prior to having the adulterous relationship. There will be consequences afterwards, but you would definitely consider them. And as I say, Shabir actually does say this, and I'll tell you where later on.
But what I'm asking here is for her well-being, and I undertook this course of action. Does it have consequences?
The course of action of having intercourse with her, having sex with her.
Having intimacy with her, yes.
Of course there'll be consequences.
Why? It was for her well-being. Why should it matter?
Okay, so he asks you, why should it matter that there are consequences for her well-being? And because it's one way of judging whether an act is moral is by looking at the consequences and assessing whether there's going to be a net positive or a net negative outcome. And we all as humans do this all the time. So in answer to his question, it is because it's a way of judging whether things are right or wrong from a moral standpoint. That's why we look at consequences.
Matter. Why should consequences matter if it was for her well-being?
Why should consequences matter if it's for her well-being? What do you mean?
I'm only going on your definition of well-being. So I'll ask again. You see, I realized that the situation has come. It was a subjective assessment, wasn't it? Yeah? I realized for her well-being, I had that relationship with her. Now I said, what are the consequences going to be like? They are going to be negative.
Okay, for so you, for or for her, or for everybody?
No. The people or the parties who are going to be concerned in this, okay? So, for example, I did it. Can I now ring the wife and tell her, by the way, you know what, I just did a good deed? Can any male do that? Exclude the creator out of this.
Yeah, sure.
Can any male confidently assert to me here that not a problem? If you did something good for a human being, you can call your wife and tell her, hey, guess what? I did a good deed for a woman.
Okay, so the question he asks is, can I ring my wife and tell her that I did a good deed? He makes the deed sound very ordinary. Remember what the deed is here. You had intimate relations with this woman to save her life. She would otherwise have committed suicide. Remember that this is his example. His somewhat crazy example, but we're going with it. So the deed itself is actually pretty remarkable. How often do you phone up your wife or tell anybody that you saved somebody's life? The fact that you had to have intimate relationships with her to save her life is a question that we can examine in the sense of, okay, so you've saved her life. That's a net positive. That's a positive thing. You saved her from dying, yet you've had to have an adulterous relationship. Which is worse, having that adulterous relationship or saving her life? And I think most reasonable people will say saving the person's life. If you were in this ridiculous situation and you had no other choice, then the whole effect of this is a net positive effect.
If you're using
that stick will come, yes, you're right.
Well, if you're using the well-being and you're saying that the consequence of not having that was her committing suicide, so she's died. My question would be, self-evident, is it not that living almost all the time is better than dying? Or would you disagree?
Although it's a diversion, I would say, okay, let me follow what you are saying.
Okay, so Shabir says this is a diversion. In fact, this is not a diversion. This is so important. This is like the crux of this example. I'm saying that living is almost always better than dying, and I think most humans on the planet would agree that. And what I'm implicitly suggesting here is that the fact that you've saved her life is an incredibly positive act. The fact that you had to have intimate relationships to save her life is what we can weigh. So a negative effect from you and your wife's point of view versus a positive effect from this woman's point of view that you've saved her life. And I think that's the crux of this entire example.
Are you, after having assessed it like that, are you still concluding and concurring with me that you will not tell your wife?
No, I'm actually saying exactly the opposite. Yes, I would tell my wife. Having assessed everything, I would phone up my wife and say, do you know what, darling? I have just saved somebody's life. The only way I could do it, unfortunately, was to have sex with her. Now, my wife would be on the other end of the phone going, well, that's a ridiculous example. And I would say, well, do you know what? That's Shabir's example. That's the one that he used. But that's the net positive effect. So would I tell my wife if this was a truthful example and everything had happened exactly the way Shabir says, because remember it's his example, then yes, I would tell my wife. A question I could have asked Shabir at this point is, are you telling me that you would not tell your wife that you have saved the life of a woman? That's a question I could have reframed and sent back to Shabir.
No, I would tell my wife.
You'd confidently tell her that, look, by the way, you know what, I slept with her.
I mean, that example sounds kind of ridiculous, but yes.
Okay, so here at this point, I only say this example sounds ridiculous. Obviously, I've said it in these comments here, but this is kind of a ridiculous example because Shabir keeps pushing me to say, would I tell my wife that I slept with a woman? What he doesn't say here and what we've obviously got to, which is the core of this issue, is yes, I would tell my wife that I slept with this woman in order to save her life. Because remember, we are going with this example and assuming that it's truthful because Shabir brought it up. We'll see later on that in fact, he relates it to court cases. And if that's the case, then we know, or we can be pretty certain that nothing like this would ever actually happen in practice.
I would honestly, do you think it's ridiculous? Do you know how many cases in court go and the charge of adultery is put against them? Now,
okay, so do you know how many cases have gone to court and the charge of adultery is put against them? This is a different point because his example is not necessarily about adultery. We've added in, or he's accepted or told me that it's not necessarily adultery. It's almost like he's doing a good deed because she was about to commit suicide. Now, if people use this example in court, obviously any sane, rational person is going to say, well, that's a ridiculous example because you could have done something else to save her life. Most cases that go to court for adultery are not going to say, well, you know what, I had sex with her to save her life. And if they do, people in the real world are going to go, well, that's ridiculous. And so he now links this to court cases of adultery. But his example is not necessarily just about adultery. There's another very bad consequence that can happen if we don't have intimate relationships with this woman. So bear that in mind.
I'm using the word adultery, well-being, psychological well-being here. We know that if we deal with the realities of life, this idea of the well-being of an individual is going to ultimately require an independent criteria. And that, I would suggest, needs to be discussed.
I agree.
Having said that...
Yes, I absolutely agree that the independent criteria for judging well-being needs to be discussed, but we do need to have a yardstick. We need some foundation against which we can bring the evidence to measure whether it's right or wrong. Otherwise, all we have is evidence and our subjective opinion. So we need something to go, okay, here's a measuring stick, here's a yardstick, here's a foundation that we can use. So I absolutely agree that the criteria for well-being needs to be discussed. And I don't think that we've got anywhere close to discussing that criteria. We've gone on to examples here. And remember, the entire discussion is around whether gay marriage is right or wrong.
Sure. I know, and you must be a very courageous man. No man worth his marbles, I would say, would do that and then call his wife and say, look, I'm sorry, I've got some bad news for you. What is it, darling? Well, are you okay with this? I'll just go outside the door and I'll say, no one in his right mind would undertake a course of action like that.
Okay, so listen to what he says there. No one would undertake a course of action like that. Let's rephrase that question like this. Would you say to somebody, assuming again that this crazy example of Shabir's is correct and everything in there is truthful, would you, as a person who is married, who had to have sex or intimate relationship with a woman to save her life, we have to go with it because this is Shabir's example. So assume that in some way that there's no other way for you to stop her taking her life. Would you phone up your wife and say, I've had intimate relationships. This woman was about to commit suicide and I had intimate relationship with her and that saved her life. Would you do that? My answer is an unequivocal yes, if we go with this example.
Now, much less about the relationship aspect. You see, as we are talking about it, the gay relationship, yes, does it have consequences?
Yes, gay relationship has consequences, and we actually established that and the actions have consequences around the 12-minute mark. So 2.5 minutes ago or more, we established that. So the question has come up again. Can you see how asking these sort of questions isn't actually getting us to the core issue? It's repeated questions. If Shabir simply stated what he believed and the reasons why, we could examine that a lot quicker and easier, and we could actually get to, you know, a point where we could have a real disagreement or an agreement or find out where one of us is right or wrong. But we don't seem to get there, unfortunately.
Do we know definitively?
Okay, so do we know definitively whether it's right or wrong? So this is probably one of the best questions that Shabir has asked, and probably without realizing it. Otherwise, he would have pursued this particular question more, because it's one of the bigger discussions around the moral position that I have, which is called consequentialism. In other words, the consequences of our actions directly relate to whether they are right and wrong. There are actually some claims against this particular position. This one of do we know definitively is actually part of that. But he asked that part of the question, then we move on to something else. So I think it sort of just came out, because if he realized how important that was, that would have been very much a thrust of a particular line of questioning that he could have asked that would have actually been quite interesting to discuss. From a moral point of view, it suggests that the rightness and wrongness of an action can be judged by the consequences of that action. So that's what consequentialism is, and that's part of my moral positioning. So it is a good question here, but I don't think Shabir recognized the entirety or the importance of that question, because we simply move on from here.
So everything has consequences.
That's negative or positive?
It seems like positive, net positive.
Net positive. Please explain how.
Okay, so Shabir now asked me to explain how I see his example. Again, slightly crazy example of sleeping with a woman because she was about to commit suicide as net positive. And obviously what I could have said here is simply what I have said already, that having sex outside of marriage is considered a negative effect. But if we weigh that against the fact that we've saved her life, we can ask the question, is this a net positive effect of saving somebody's life balanced against having sex outside of marriage? And in my view, this is a net positive effect. That's what I should have said here, but of course, I don't actually say it in those words or anything quite like that.
Happy people, in other words, they're happy with each other.
Okay, so that's definitely not a good answer. What I just said previously was a lot better than saying happy people.
Someone were happy people.
Yes.
It's not about not being the same. It's about this psychological well-being. You see, because in terms, as I did say, on a physical level, okay, the evidence that we are going to assess is something that would have to be necessarily objective. Do we agree? The answer should be yes.
What are you talking about, objective? Oh.
Okay. Anything that we talk about, for example, you raise.
You're talking about well-being.
No. If you raise the issue of get married.
Yes.
Now, on a subjective basis, we can all feel very nice and warm inside because of a particular kind of relationship. But the reality is completely different. We know that.
Okay, so here I should have asked the question. He says we can all feel warm inside, but the reality is very different, and we know that. So that's a very confident statement. What I should have done here is say, please explain how the reality is different from what you view as feeling all warm and inside. Tell me how the reality is different. Because you've used an example here which hasn't proven your point, and now you've asserted that the reality is very different and that we know that. Please explain how we know that. Unfortunately, of course, I don't ask that, but that would be a question to ask at this point, because he's made a confident assertion here that the reality is different from the warm feeling we get inside.
Can you not pick up?
No, I'm trying to work out. Is it South Africa or...
Okay, so here we go off on a tangent asking me about my accent for some reason.
Are you South Africa? Oh, well, then I'm your neighbor. That's all right. Yes, I was from Malawi.
Yes, me too.
Okay.
If you hire Uganda,
yeah? I said this.
Long distance neighbor.
To me, okay? We have got so much to consider in life, yeah? However, in every society, there are certain rules. Those rules were developed for the well-being of the communities.
Correct. Could they be wrong?
Guaranteed, there's a possibility they can. But if they are wrong, okay, then evidence will be found before changes take place. Like, for example, in this country also, statutes are created. The statutes come onto the statute book. After a number of years, they will be repealed.
Okay, so this is quite important. Shabir now brings up the example of statutes. So statutes are like laws that come onto the books, into the law of the country, and then he says they are repealed. So basically what he says is, or what he intimates to say here is that over time we change the laws to presumably improve them and make them better for society as a whole. So I want you to remember that at this point, at around just under the 17-minute mark in this video, Shabir now uses the example of statutes, in other words, laws on the law books. So now we are looking at this from a moral standpoint. We've sort of moved away from the gay relationship, or we've taken a detour away from gay marriage and whether that's right or wrong, to look at statutes on the law books.
Why? Because evidence has been found that the way it was actually put down was not necessarily the way it should be. But now...
How did they come to that? This is now better than that.
Research.
Okay, so this is an important question. I say, how do they come to the conclusion that laws get repealed and new ones come in that are presumably better than the old ones? And Shabir says, research. What I should have asked for, what I should have pressed here is, what yardstick do they use? What foundation do they use? Because having research on it on its own isn't meaningful. What we need is to have the research and then measure the research against something that we can test and go, yes, it's better or it's worse. If we don't have this thing, this yardstick, this foundation, how do we test to say a statute is better or worse than what the previous one was on the books?
But I am agreeing with you. In fact, I'm the one who is advocating the research element. Because at this point...
But we can research and come up with different options. So what is the standard that we can use to determine these different options? And I suggest it's the well-being of humans in this case, because we're talking about statutes on the books, the laws that govern a human society. But more broadly, I could say the well-being of conscious creatures, in other words, all creatures on the planet. For example, you know, is it a moral act to hurt an animal that can feel pain? Now, we don't believe that ants can feel pain, so we could, you know, if somebody really wanted to, they could, quote, torture an ant, but maybe ants could feel pain. But we do know that higher level animals like mammals, dogs, cats do feel pain. So we can confidently assess that causing a moral act for an animal is a negative thing. So it's morally reprehensible. But we use a standard to judge that. And that's the part that we never really get to, unfortunately, here.
When we raise the issue, I would suggest, okay, fair enough. What is the evidence for us to confidently determine either way it is true?
What Shabir actually should have asked is, what is the standard against which we can measure the evidence in order to determine whether it's better or worse than what we currently have or do in society? But he's using evidence as his yardstick rather than giving me what the foundation is that evidence can be used to measure against.
You see, because if we take the method that we have employed currently in the world of how to establish certain things, then we will also agree that part of that is that when we find something, we will still say, this is not necessarily absolutely the truth.
Okay, so this is actually a very important point. A lot of theistic people do this, and even some non-theistic, some atheists say this. If you hear the word absolute truth, trigger warnings, you need to have a little red bell go off in your head. Because whenever somebody uses the word absolute truth or absolute anything, we need to just be very careful with that. Because if you look into philosophy, which is the way people think and how do we come to know some of the things that we know, and what can be known absolutely is actually very little. And the word absolute is a bit of a red herring, because if we actually had to follow that through, we would find that through philosophical thinking over the last couple of hundred or thousands of years, we would find that actually there's not a lot that we can know absolutely if we really dig deep into that. So absolute, if I hear the word absolute, for me personally, that's a red herring, and I should have called it out here. I didn't. I allowed that to continue. But just be aware of anybody, whether it's an atheist or a theist, that says, hey, I absolutely know this, or this is absolutely right. Your very next response should be, how do you determine that's absolutely right? And do you know what absolutely right actually means? Most people don't. They just use it in conversations to what they really mean is, I'm quite confident that what I believe or what I'm saying is true. That's not the same as saying it's absolutely right. So just be aware of that little word, absolutely or absolute truth.
Current. It might be
the
something
best explanation
else.
We
so
have
far.
Currently.
It
yes.
might be something else. Now, on that, I have no problem. Yes? But then, can we now formulate, and this is going to sound odd, if me and you were to say, okay, we will formulate our reasoning based on the limited information we have. If we are going to do that, can we then rightfully start advocating that opinion as one that is true?
Okay, so let me say that question again. He asked, can we formulate our reasoning on the limited information we have? Can we rightly start advocating that that opinion is one that is true? Now, this is a very, what I would consider, uncharitable way to phrase the question. Listen to the way I phrase the question and then see whether the question actually means the same thing, but does it sound different when I say it? So here goes. With all the information and knowledge we have at this point, over the last few thousand years, using the best evidence and reasoning we have, can we rightfully advocate the moral point, not just an opinion, the moral point as one that is true? And in my view, yes. And we can do this in all progressive societies because this is what we do. And we use most often some kind of a yardstick. Most people don't know that they're using the yardstick of well-being, but they are actually using it subjectively, or should I say, they're using it subconsciously, not subjectively, subconsciously. So that the way I phrased the question versus the way he phrased it is very different, and essentially it means the same thing. So again, it's a very uncharitable way of phrasing the question. It almost means like we don't know anything. Are we able to then use our opinion as something that we should advocate to other people? And when I phrase the question, as in, with all the knowledge we have at this point over the last few thousand years, using the best evidence and reasoning we have, can we rightfully advocate that a moral point, not just an opinion, is one that is true? And so when we phrase it that way, I think the obvious answer is yes. He wants me to say no.
If you have enough evidence for sure.
This is definitely not a good answer. So what I've just said is a far better answer. Remember, obviously, we're in the heat of a discussion here. So I definitely said something that wasn't a good answer here, as in, have we got if we have enough evidence, then sure. But the better answer is what I said above. And if we use, in this case, remember the statutes is what we're referring to here, the well-being of humans. And we've researched and come up with good evidence and a reason why a new course of action or statute should be implemented and the old one repealed to provide a higher state of well-being, then yes, we can advocate that. So that's a much better way of phrasing. And I just said, you know, yes, if we have enough evidence, which is definitely not a good answer.
If we have enough evidence, what is enough evidence?
Something that is able to be tested, retested all over the show. Give me an example, because otherwise
okay.
High level.
You cannot psychologically test my level of emotion for my child, can you?
They could test to a degree, sure.
Okay, so we've now moved away from the statutes. Remember, the statutes was the original point we were making here. We've now, Shabir now goes on to say, can we test the level of emotion he has for his child here, which is a very different question to, can we confidently assert that a moral position is correct if we put it on the statute books after a lot of research and using a yardstick, for example, like the well-being of humans? I'm not aware of a way to test the psychological level of well-being of a child, but we can show that you have a positive emotion towards your child. And I don't think there's any reason in the future to think that we won't advance technology enough to be able to detect the actual level, not just the positive emotion, but the actual level to which someone feels positive or negative towards a particular proposition. In this case, for example, his child. But to what degree, that will be hard to say. So this is really a kind of diversion, and it's a diversion because I gave a poor answer, which was that in order to confidently assert something, we need to have more evidence. What I should have answered further up, of course, was that we use a yardstick, and of course that we can find a way on the statute books to confidently assert that a new statute is better than an old one. But because I gave a poor reply here, we're now on to a different example here, which is a much more, in a sense, subjective. Although, as I say, I do think we can test, certainly to some level, the psychological emotion that you have for your child, not necessarily the level.
what is creative freedom?
So putting you into a machine, looking at what does the brain do compared to somebody who doesn't, who hates somebody, and so they can see the difference. You can't measure it in the sense of like look at a number, but you can see there's a
right. But now, you know, respectfully, I would suggest, you know, if you look at how these tests are assessed, it is based on what? The wings?
Oh, not necessarily the brain lighting up.
No.
And they do comparison, so it's right. Not just how we'll think it's the best.
You're absolutely right. You see, the brain lighting up. What is that actually showing?
Okay, so when the brain lights up in an ECG machine, what is that actually showing is Shabir's question, which is kind of a good question. And what it shows is the part of the brain is active when certain stimulus, either positive or negative, is introduced to the subject who's being tested. So either questions are asked or they're asked to imagine certain things, then the brain lights up. And we can correlate this with different areas of the brain, and we can see whether something has a negative effect on the brain in the sense of which part of the brain lights up, and we can see what has a positive effect. So that's what this sort of test is designed to do. I don't quite phrase it like that, unfortunately, my reply here.
That's showing, that's a representation of I'm feeling quite good. You use the word good.
Now, happy. Was the definition of good predefined? Well, for you to be able to test, assess, and establish, yes, this is like this, you would have had a yardstick prior.
Yes, so you'd have done a lot of tests prior. And go, oh, it lights up like this, it lights up like that, it does all of these. Which one of them? And then you correlate them.
Okay, so on what basis was the first definition established?
Okay, so now at this point, in terms of this particular test, Shabir is looking for a foundation. What's the yardstick, was his word, that we use? I wish he had done that with the actual moral example itself, but now he's asking for it in this particular test case. This question is purely to suggest or attempt to show that the first way of setting up this whole test experiment was subjective. And by implication, then we can't be absolutely sure that it's accurate. So I don't think that this is a useful question to ask at this point on this particular experiment. The foundation and the objective criteria or yardstick is a very important question to ask about morality itself, but not necessarily about this particular experiment.
The first one that defined what happiness is.
So they would have tested ahead of time, not knowing.
You know, when you said they would have, what do you mean by that?
So they would.
You mean, are you not familiar with the evidence? You are just assuming.
Yes, I am assuming that they would have done tests. So I don't know the exact protocol they would have used in their test. But for some reason, this is very important to Shabir, because what he could then show is that, oh, well, the tests are subjective. In other words, you know, they're just making stuff up. And of course, if we are somewhat familiar with the scientific method and rigorous testing, we know that that's the exact opposite of what they do. You know, they are very clear to try and avoid subjectivity and keep it as objective as possible.
So at some point, people go, oh, maybe there's a way that we can look into it, that we can potentially assess how brains operate. We don't know yet. So we will do a range of tests on different people around the world, men, women, whatever, and we'll assess. And we'll ask them, and we'll do certain things that gives them a state of feeling good. I think most humans are kind of aware when you're feeling good and when you're not feeling good. Do you agree? You can recognize the difference.
Possibly, yes.
So they would have done that. So now they would have tested, let's say, 100,000.
Here is what I would suggest is that it's the case. Yeah. Because it is a subject matter worth considering. Yeah?
Okay, so Shabir suggests that it's a subject matter worth considering. What I should have asked here, what exactly is the subject matter that you are talking about that is worth considering? Because if I have to assume what he means here, to me, the subject is of minor interest. In other words, knowing that these tests first took place and how people are tested today to assess their emotional level is kind of interesting, but it's not the main point of our discussion. Our discussion is not really about, okay, well, how was the first test set up to check how your brain lights up and to measure against that? That is, if we think about it, yes, it's an interesting point, but it's nowhere near as important as the bigger moral questions and how we can determine what is right and wrong and what standard we use to determine it. That's the big question. This is kind of very much a side issue.
Do you reside in the UK then? You do? Right. Why don't we do this? Yes? Because you have nearly read the full book of Sam Harris.
Yeah.
Why don't we meet up again? Let's decide on a subject matter. Okay? Then we can do the necessary research and come back so that we can discuss it based on evidence rather than speculation. What do you think?
I think it would be great to have another broader discussion on morality to discuss both mine and Shabir's and what foundation we use, and is one better than the other. If Shabir can demonstrate that his foundation for morality is better than mine, then I would have to submit that his is better and I would have to follow his rather than use mine. So this is a really good conversation to have. What are our moral foundations and why do we believe that they are useful ways to operate in the world? That would be a really great discussion.
Yeah, so what do you think the subject matter is you want to choose? I don't mind whatever it is. Now, if it is going to be based on Sam Harris's book, then I think it's going to be about morality.
Yes, it would be if that was the case. So we could do that.
Okay, we can. How about
that? Tell me what's your foundation for morality, because that's essentially in a sense.
What is the definition of morality?
What's your foundation?
Well, before I answer that, you need to tell me, when you are saying what's your foundation for morality, what's the definition of morality?
Okay, so notice what I did there. I asked Shabir, what is your foundation for morality? He doesn't answer that question directly. He then asked me, what do I mean by morality? Anybody that's even somewhat familiar with the subject will immediately have some yardstick that they can go against, or, as I noticed many atheists do, which I don't subscribe to, many atheists are relativists. They say, okay, well, I don't have a yardstick. We just do what we think is best at the time in our civilization. That's what's called a moral relativist point of view, and I don't subscribe to that. I don't think that's a defensible position, because that essentially means that might is right and whatever's right in that time is right. And if we look back over history, that's not the best way to do it, because somebody like Hitler could come into the world and say, killing all the Jews is what I consider right. And if at the time he's in charge, then that would be considered right. So the moral relativist position of whatever's right in the moment is not, I believe, a defensible position for a moral view. What I've asked Shabir is, what is your foundation? Normally, when I ask this of most Muslims, they will say the Quran. The Quran is how I get my morals, how I know what is right and wrong. I refer to the Quran and that will tell me. That's called divine command theory. That's the broad name given to theists who look at the book, be it the Quran or the Bible, and get their morals from the book. But Shabir definitely doesn't want to answer that question and say that. Actually, that is probably what he does, but he's just not willing to say it in this conversation.
So, like the good and bad. How do you decide what? How is it decided in your worldview between what's good and what's
bad? Okay, so Shabir says evidence. Let's just see if that's in fact the case.
Evidence alone?
Yes.
So you don't need a creator at all?
You don't need a creator until the evidence shows you something else.
Okay, so he says you don't need a creator unless the evidence shows you something else. So if we were to accept that's his view, his foundation for morality is based on evidence alone, but I just don't think he really understands the question clearly. I didn't ask what method we use to gain the information to make a case for a moral position, but rather what yardstick would he use to test and measure that evidence. And as you can see, he doesn't really answer that question, either because he's not sure or because he just doesn't want to give me his foundation. What does he use to test whether something's right and wrong? Is it his own brain? He won't go with my own brain, because that's a relativist position. Most people won't accept relativism, in other words, what I think in the moment. They will use some criteria against which to judge moral actions right or wrong.
So you don't look at the Quran, you don't use a creator, you evaluate the world mechanism.
Yeah, I will evaluate it through the evidence available. Yeah, what will you do?
The same thing.
Okay, so here I make the mistake of agreeing with Shabir that evidence is the foundation to judge morals. And this is simply incorrect on both our parts, as I've mentioned earlier. Muslims normally use the Quran as their foundation or benchmark, as the yardstick to judge what is right and wrong. And I would use the well-being of conscious creatures and the scientific method as described in Sam Harris's book, The Moral Landscape. I believe that gives a very compelling point of view or argument for a non-believer having an objective yardstick to use to assess what's right and wrong. So I've made a mistake in agreeing with Shabir here, because actually that's not the yardstick, that's not the foundation. Evidence isn't the foundation. It's evidence is used against something, and then we can make the moral case.
So we are in agreement.
But then why would you need the Quran?
There you are. You see, if you heard me carefully, I had said to you, if you came across something, okay, you have evaluated everything, yes, and then you came across information which totally agrees with what you are saying, would you accept that evidence?
Okay, so let me repeat that question, because that was a rather long and unwieldy question, and it could be restated as follows. But let me first repeat his question, then I'll restate it. Shabir asked, if you came across something and you had evaluated everything, note the term there, you had evaluated everything, then you came across information which totally agrees with what you are saying, would you accept that as evidence? So here's another way of putting that. If you had evaluated everything you could on a particular topic and came to a conclusion and then came across information which agrees with your conclusion, would you accept that as evidence? And my position is no, I would simply accept that that information agrees with the conclusion I've already reached. So it would not count as additional evidence unless it added something new or additional information. But he doesn't say that. He says that you've evaluated everything and then you came across information. What he should have said was you came across additional information. He doesn't say that. And so if he had said that, as he will do later on, I would have then immediately have picked that up.
Evidence or the
that information is evidence. Yeah?
You're talking about the book as evidence.
I didn't say book. I said if I found that information, if that information, for example, is contained in a book which has the cover of Sam Harris, would you agree?
So if
that evidence shows, yes.
And then I look at that, and
yes,
Sam Harris,
says, yeah, it seems to agree.
That says the same thing.
Yes.
I will say,
you
yes, that agrees with that. I wouldn't say this is evidence.
Yeah.
I'd say this agrees with what we've...
Absolutely. Yeah. So I agree with you.
Okay, so Shabir says, absolutely, I agree with you. So you agree that it would not count as evidence when you previously asserted that it would be evidence. I think Shabir mistakenly contradicted himself here because he's quite used to saying, I agree with you. But actually, he doesn't agree with me, as you'll clearly hear now.
And then I would ask myself a further question in what you just said. Wait a minute, if this information is agreeing with all this and all the research that was undertaken has led us to this conclusion, how did this end up in here?
Why would you ask that then?
I'll tell you why. I will tell you why. Because everything seems to have a history. Yeah? Why in the world would you exclude a piece of information and consider how that information arrived where it is?
Okay, so at this point, Shabir asks, why in the world would we exclude a piece of information? He doesn't say additional information. He says information. And bear in mind, we've spoken previously that this information will confirm what we already know. So why would we exclude a piece of information and consider how that information arrived here? I answer, why use the book or information as backup? And we get tangled up a little because here, instead of stating his claim directly, Shabir wants to ask me multiple questions to try and arrive at his predetermined position. And that may feel like the best way to do things, by asking questions and getting somebody else to potentially arrive at his proposition. But I suggest it'd be quicker and better if you state your proposition and then we can discuss it. So Shabir could have said, you know what, I think that that having a book that has information is the best, you know, one would use that as evidence, and therefore I think that could be very useful. Now we could examine this. But he's asking me the question sort of background, so to speak, for me to try and answer his question for him.
Because we've already got the conclusion, haven't we? We've already agreed, so why are you using the book as a backup?
I never even said the book. What I am saying to you is, look, if, for example, and here is one that we can consider. If I tell you, you know what, aliens definitely had land on Earth, is it beyond the realm of possibility? It isn't. So there's a possibility it can happen. So if I were to turn around and tell you, right, you know what, it claims it's from aliens, would you study it?
What do you mean it claims?
Whatever this information is, I'm just using it as an example. Yeah, this information seems to suggest that it is from an alien race. Would you not want to consider that? Or would you just say, well, we've got the conclusion, I'm dismissing it. Because it is now, the problem here is this, that if the brother says, okay, why would you need to? Then he has just contradicted his very own foundation in terms of the methodology.
Okay, so here Shabir uses aliens landing on Earth as an example. And Shabir then says, this information claims it's from aliens. Would I, Rob, not want to consider that? If I knew everything about the aliens and this information simply agreed with what I already knew, which ensures that this analogy is the same as the previous one, because remember the previous ones said we had evaluated everything, so we need to have consistency between these different examples. So assuming I already knew everything about aliens and this information just basically agreed with what I already knew, then I would not consider it additional information since I already knew about it. So again, we get tangled up in these questions here where, as I suggest, Shabir could just make his assertion, make his claim and give his reasons, then we can confidently go in and actually discuss them.
Because we know, as we agreed, that if you get to a certain point, it doesn't necessarily mean it is entire. There may be something else that might not. Do you agree?
Okay, so he says, when you get to a certain point, it doesn't mean that it's entire. But that's exactly what he suggested in the previous two examples. He literally said that if you come across something and you have evaluated everything, then you can come across information that totally agrees with what you are saying. Would you accept that as evidence? Now he says, when you get to a certain point, it doesn't mean that it's entire. I guess what he means is that you've evaluated everything. So he's now got a completely different example, and this is contradictory and very confusing since we're using a different example and we're not being consistent. I think this is part of the reason why I think it's much better for Shabir if he simply states his propositions and the reason for believing in them, and then we can evaluate it. Because by asking different questions and using different examples and not staying consistent, it becomes quite confusing, as you might hopefully see.
Yes, you do. So, if I were to say that this is additional information which may possibly provide you additional evidence for your contention.
Sure, you didn't say that initially. No. Hear you say that.
Okay, so he didn't actually say that. If you rewind this tape and I've listened to it very carefully, he didn't say before that it's additional information. He explicitly says additional information at this very moment and claims that I didn't hear him because I had these preconceived ideas. And with great respect to Shabir, that's simply not true. I didn't hear him say additional information because he didn't say that. And if he intimated that, that's not good enough. He does need to be very explicit and clear on what he's actually saying. He's now introduced additional information. And of course, if the book or the information from aliens or whatever had additional information from what I already knew, then yes, I would take that into account.
You didn't hear me because you had no preconceived idea. What I said is the information is there. Consider it.
Sure.
Why not? There's no harm. So I would do that.
That's additional information. Of course I would do that.
It would be. Now, I am saying exactly that. So on that basis, if we were to say, let's look at this, you know, the benefit element, as you pointed out. If we consider that, God willing, when we are back here the next time, at least we can discuss it based on evidence. What do you think?
Oh, you mean here? I thought you died and we came back to life. I'm like, what?
Complex steps
ahead. We're coming here again next Sunday or whatever.
No, not next Sunday.
Okay, so this is definitely my fault. I'm a little tired by this stage, and I thought Shabir was talking about coming back in another life. I don't know why I thought that. Don't ask. It's just at the end of a very long conversation. This is part two. This whole conversation went on for an hour. So at this point, when he said coming back, he meant coming back to Speaker's Corner, and I thought he meant like coming back in the next life or something like that. So definitely my mistake. Okay, so this is pretty much the end. There's a couple more minutes if you look at the original video, but there's nothing of substance in there. So I hope this has been useful. It's been very instructive for me to notice where I've missed things, to notice some of the ways that Shabir talks, because I know a lot of Muslims respect Shabir, and I respect him as a person. Having reviewed this conversation, I do think, as I say, that there's a couple of things that I think Shabir could do differently that could actually make the conversation more valuable. We could move towards finding out what is true in a better and easier and less confusing way. If Shabir states his views on things, gives his reasons why, I'm happy to do the same, and now we can evaluate it. but by Shabir asking me multiple questions, small questions, to try and get to a proposition which he could state himself, I think it becomes unnecessarily long and confusing. So I certainly don't agree with anything. And by the end here, we really haven't come to any sort of agreement or disagreement, a real substantial disagreement on is gay marriage right or wrong. We've been all around, as you can see, but we haven't really established the point from a psychological level that gay marriage is wrong. And really, that's what we should have done. And in future, I will keep the main question in my mind as best I can and refer back to that so that we can actually keep on track and not get diverted with other examples and analogies and so forth. So again, thank you very much for listening if you've got all the way through this. If there's any other discussions you'd like me to review or to critique, then let me know in the comments. And as I get time, I'll be able to do it. It does take quite a while to prepare this and then obviously to record it and upload it. So I hope you appreciate the time I've taken. Whether you agree with me or not, please leave your comments. Like the video if you think it's at least been valuable, even if you don't agree with me. And put your comments in there. Let me know what you think I could have done differently or better, or where you think I've made a mistake in my assessment of Shabir or myself.